Good morning, everybody. We're trying something new this morning. I'm assuming all of you are in your living room, just relaxing, so we're joining you in our living room. The lighting isn't the best. I hope you can see everything okay. The boys have been given strict instructions that they're going to be quiet the whole time. We're going to see how this goes. I haven't figured out the consequences if they don't listen. But I want to welcome you to this beautiful Easter Sunday morning. He is risen. It's a beautiful, beautiful thought. More so today, I think, than any other Easter, because of everything that's going on around us, he's still alive, and the tomb is empty. We can, beyond a shadow of a doubt, know that we are facing what we're facing, but we're not facing it alone, because he's alive with us. He's with us. He walked with us, and he talks with us. I hope you have your bread and your juice close by. As I said earlier on my message, I think last evening, doesn't matter what for bread or juice you have. It can be Ritz crackers. It's fine. Just so you have something that you can join me and my family in communion at the end of this message. Before I start today's message, I want to share with you just a few thoughts that have been going through my head here the last few days. And I hope you take this for the heart that it's intended. I've been increasingly concerned over the last few days, weeks, I guess, but mostly the last couple days, of all the negativity I'm seeing on social media. This leader's doing a terrible job. We're doomed. It's only going to get worse. There's a big conspiracy, and on the list goes. And what's starting to concern me is I fully expect that there's going to be a widely varied group of opinions out there, and that's fine, because that's what freedom is about. But some of those opinions I'm seeing are getting really harsh. And there are arguments that are springing out of them. And that concerns me. Put it on silent. Pause for a second. Sorry, I forgot to put my phone on silent. Whoever texted me, thank you. Anyhow, here's my concern and my plea for us as Christians. Can we put aside our own... Is it still going? Okay. Can we put aside our own opinions? Can we be less concerned about our point of view and winning an argument and instead focus on what we should be celebrating right now? I guess it was Friday night, or Friday all day, really, and then Sunday, today, this morning, I was so thankful to see all of the positivity that I saw regarding Good Friday and the resurrection far outweighed the negativity. And I think that's beautiful. That needs to keep on going because it is Easter. We're serving a risen Savior and we're having an awesome time of the year to celebrate. So with that being said, I'm going to share something I just received by email yesterday. And you might think I'm reading The Grinch That Stole Christmas, but it's not. It's called The Virus That Stole Easter. 'Twas late in 19 when the virus began, bringing chaos and fear to all people each land. People were sick, hospitals full, doctors overwhelmed, no one in school. As winter gave way to the promise of spring, the virus raged on, touching peasant and king. People hid in their homes from the enemy unseen. They YouTubed and Zoomed, social distanced and cleaned. April approached and churches were closed. There won't be an Easter, the world supposed. There won't be church services and egg hunts are out. No reason for new dresses when we can't go about. Holy Week started as bleak as the rest. The world was focused on masks and on tests. Easter can't happen this year, they proclaimed. Online and at home, it just won't be the same. Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, the days came and went. The virus pressed on. It just would not relent. The world woke Sunday and nothing had changed. The virus still menaced, the people estranged. Poo-poo to all the saints, the world was grumbling. They're finding out now that, oh, Easter is coming. They're just waking up. I know just what they'll do. Their mouths will hang open a minute or two. And then all the saints will all cry, boo-hoo. That noise, said the world, would be something to hear. So it paused. And the world put a hand to its ear, and it did hear a sound coming all through the skies. It started down low, then it started to rise. But the sound wasn't depressed. Why, this sound was triumphant. It couldn't be so, but it grew with abundance. The world stared around, popping its eyes. Then it shook. What it saw was a shocking surprise. Each saint in each nation, the tall and the small, was celebrating Jesus in spite of it all. It hadn't stopped Easter from coming. It came. Somehow or other, it came just the same. And the world, with its life quite stuck in quarantine, stood puzzling and puzzling. Just how can it be? It came without bonnets, it came without bunnies, it came without egg hunts, cantatas, or money. Then the world thought of something it hadn't before. Maybe Easter, it thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Easter perhaps means a little bit more. And what happened then? Well, the story's not done. What will you do? Will you share with that one or two or more people needing hope in this night? Will you share the source of your life in this fight? The churches are empty, but so is the tomb. And Jesus is victor over death, doom, and gloom. So this year at Easter, let this be our prayer. As the virus still rages all around, everywhere, may the world see hope when it looks at God's people. May the world see the church is not a building or steeple. May the world find faith in Jesus' death and resurrection. May the world find joy in a time of dejection. May 2020 be known as the year of survival. Not only that, let it start a revival. May it be so, everybody. May it be so. May a revival spring out of this tragedy, chaos that we're seeing. So just for a few moments here, this Easter Sunday morning, can we put aside all of our opinions and frustrations and instead focus on what is right now, our risen Savior? Give us a few seconds, we're going to get repositioned and I'm going to share the message with you. You can watch the boys while we get set up. For my message this morning, I want to share something with you Montgomery folks will recognize I've done from time to time, and if you don't come here to church at Montgomery, this might be a little different for you, but most of the people at Montgomery know very well that I love music. I just am constantly thinking of words to a song at certain places and messages and Bible studies, whatever, just songs come to mind so often, and I feel beyond a shadow of a doubt that Scripture is inspired by God, without question, but I also feel like songs are inspired by God. Those songs that are uplifting, encouraging, and convicting, and worshipful. So many songs that God has inspired writers to share with us that have helped us through difficult days. And I was thinking this past week, and I just am amazed how the Lord's been working, because honestly, I've been at a loss as to what to share to you because this is so different, the time we're living. But this week, I just couldn't get the song Because He Lives out of my mind. I kept thinking about the song. I couldn't get past it. And I felt like, you know what? I think God wants me to use that as my theme this morning. And so if you folks at Montgomery remember, sometimes I would take the words to a song, make that my outline, and then use scripture to support those words to those songs. And so I want to use the song Because He Lives with you today. Let me read the first verse and chorus with you, and then I'll go back and discuss it. I shouldn't have to read these words, probably everybody knows them, but just as a reminder, God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future. And life is worth the living just because He lives. I just want to take these words I read with you, and then I want to see what the Bible has to say about these phrases in this song. First phrase is, God sent His Son. When God Almighty created the beautiful paradise called Eden, and He put Adam and Eve in it to live, He made it perfect. But Adam and Eve sinned, thereby causing sin to enter the human race. And even though God knew that was going to happen, it still grieved him. He wanted to some way to show mankind how to get back to him. So he came up with the most awesome, incredible plan ever created. He came to earth in the form of his son. Galatians 4, 4 and 5. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Jesus came to earth as a baby to grow up among men, to experience the pain and suffering that mankind experienced, to go through temptation, but ultimately to die a terrible death, to buy our pardon. And I know I'm briefly hitting on the high points and leaving out many, many details that we don't have time for, but the point I want you to get is God sent his son. He didn't have to, but he did it because it was the only way for us to get back to him. Second phrase says, he came to love, heal, and forgive. Everything good? I have my sister texting my wife if there's an issue, so I'm not sure if we're good yet, but he came to love, heal, and forgive. What did Jesus come to do? What did God's Son come to do? He came to love. Jesus is our ultimate example of love. Everything he did was about love. He loved in every word and every action and every situation. He lived and he died love. John 15, 13 says, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. He calls us his friends if we accept his gift of love. There is a verse to a very well-known song called The Love of God, a very, very powerful hymn. And every time I sing this one verse, it gets me. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made? Were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade? To write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. I don't know how that verse affects you, but that's a whole lot of writers with a whole lot of pens, with a whole lot of ink being used on a whole lot of paper, and yet it still wouldn't be enough supplies to describe the love Jesus Christ has for us. He came to heal and forgive. I put these two together because they go together. Yes, Jesus is a great physician. He's healed many people physically throughout Scripture and over the years, but that isn't what I want to focus on. We all know the story of the guy that was paralyzed and his four buddies had him drop in to see Jesus. Let me pick up reading in Mark 2, verse 5. So when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven you. And some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus with themselves, he said to them, why do you reason about these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk? Jesus is telling them, hey, it's a whole lot easier for me to heal a person physically than it is to give eternal healing, because that is so much more complex. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. Immediately he rose, took up the bed, and went out in the presence of them all, so that all were amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. I truly believe Jesus healed all that he did during his time on earth simply to give proof of his power. No one up to that point had even heard of being completely forgiven for sins. Up until that point, it was just a temporary time, occasion-by-occasion forgiveness. So he needed to give them a visual sign of his power. And many people wouldn't know if they were forgiven by sins. There wouldn't be an obvious sign. They wouldn't be able to tell so much in some situations. But if a person was healed physically, they could see how powerful Jesus was. So because Jesus loved us, loves us, he came to heal us by forgiving us. And my question is, have you had this heart healing? This resurrection day is a perfect opportunity for you to accept this healing of the heart. And I beg you, if you've never done this, if you're watching this morning, if you've never been to church in your life, if you've never prayed, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, ask him into your heart. Accept this heart healing. You'll never be sorry. And then you can experience an eternal life spent with him in heaven. The next phrase says, he lived and died to buy my pardon. The only way for Jesus to provide the healing and the forgiveness was to live here on earth and die a sacrificial death as the perfect and unblemished sacrifice, as heaven's perfect lamb. Ephesians 1 verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. He paid a debt he didn't owe. I owed a debt I couldn't pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. Praise God, he paid it completely and fully. I'm debt free. You're debt free. You can be. We have this pardon through his sacrifice. Pardon from sin that we couldn't get any other way. And again, if you've not experienced this pardon, it's an awesome day to do it. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives, is the next phrase in the song. What is the proof that Jesus is alive? An empty grave. I'm sure you've seen all the memes already on Facebook. The church is empty, but praise God, so is the tomb. When the two women came to anoint Jesus' body that morning, they didn't find him there, and they were scared. And then the angel showed up, and then they were more afraid. What did the angel tell them? Matthew 28, 5 and 6. The angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come, see the place where the Lord lay. Aren't you so incredibly thankful that the grave is empty? So many other religions can't say that. We are the only true religion, the only true belief that we have a Savior, a God who is alive. You ask me how I know he lives? He lives in my heart. The next phrase, actually beginning of the chorus of this song, says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. So I'm just curious, and you can raise your hands. No, I'm just kidding. Anyone concerned about tomorrow? Or next week, or next month, what they may bring. Yeah, I'll admit, there are days I'm pretty concerned about that. When are we going to go back to normal, and how is this going to work out? And if we go back to normal, is everything going to go crazy because the virus isn't stopped yet? You know, all those things are floating around. But we're reminded, because he lives, we don't have to face it alone. Jesus tells us on the Sermon on the Mount, about how God takes care of the grass and the birds and the flowers and so on. Why shouldn't he take care of us? Because we are of so much more value to him than anything else. He died for us after all. Shouldn't he value us a little bit more than the grass and the flowers? So he tells us in Matthew 6, 34, therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. In other words, we have enough to worry about today. We have enough to deal with today. Like, I'm dealing with making sure everyone's seeing this right now, and it gets a little stressful, so I'm going to worry about that right now. We have enough to deal with today. Let's take it one day at a time, knowing Jesus is with us. Because he lives, we can then face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Most of you from Montgomery should remember the last time we were together, I shared a sermon called Fear, He is a Liar, from one of my favorite songs that is entitled the same. And I also shared the verse that I have hanging on my wall that my grandparents gave me when I was born, well, they gave my parents. And the verse is 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love, and of a sound mind. Jesus didn't come to bring fear. He came to bring peace. And we know that God isn't the author of confusion, but peace. Therefore, if you're experiencing irrational fear, it's from Satan. God says, I didn't give you that. Remember that. Satan wants us to get our focus off of God and the peace he can bring. Since he lives, fear doesn't need to control us. And then the song goes on to say, because I know he holds the future. We don't know what the future is going to hold, but I do know the one that holds the future. I could say how the future is going to be bright and cheery and everything's going to be good and it's going to be great because we're Christians and we just have a perfect life. And we know that's not true. We will face times, and we're currently facing hard times. But I know this to be true. 1 Peter 1:3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. The second verse in Because He Lives talks about a newborn baby and how this baby can face uncertain days because he lives. Well, I think you'd agree that these days are definitely uncertain. But with Jesus, we know he has things in control and we can face the future knowing he lives. Our future on earth might not be always cheery. In fact, it's probably not going to be always cheery. But to the child of God, that isn't our ultimate future. Our future is spending eternity in heaven with him. And that is a bright future. So therefore, the last line in this chorus says, and life is worth the living just because he lives. There's an old deeply spiritual song that says, life ain't worth living. Unfortunately, there's a lot of people that feel that way, and we see the results of that far too often in a very tragic way. But I'm here to tell you that life spent with Jesus is worth living. John 20, 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Knowing Jesus gives us this fresh purpose, this new meaning to life. No, it's not always peaches and cream, and many times it's not. But it's a life worth living because we know we'll see him someday. I don't know of any life I'd rather live than the Christian life. For me, life is worth living because I serve the risen Savior. I trust this is an encouragement for you. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And I'm going to play that song for you here in a few minutes as my family and I do communion together. We're going to start that here in just a second. And I'll give you a few minutes to get prepared there as I share, say a few words. But this Easter has been a different time for sure. We had a drive-through communion here the other night. And while that maybe didn't feel appropriate or the correct form, it's not so much in the form or even the ingredients that we're using, but in the fact that we're worshiping our Savior who died for us and is alive today. Every time we do communion, it should be a reminder of the incredible sacrifice Jesus paid for us that we can go free and spend eternity in heaven with him. So if you're ready, I'm going to get our communion elements together and share with my family and share a few words with you. So give me a few minutes here. As you see, I have a very small plate for the size of cups and bread that I have here. The traditional communion elements are grape juice and unleavened bread. And they represent, of course, Christ's body and his blood. And I'm not going to do each individually. You can do it all together as we are doing it, but I just want to say a few words about what they represent. And we think about the body of Christ. We think about the physical suffering that he went through. I am a very squeamish person. probably because I've been too hard on my hands and have lost a few appendages over the years, and I just can't handle to see someone suffer. And I would imagine, just like if I'm watching a movie or seeing a sport and someone gets injured, I have to look away. I can't handle watching it. I would imagine if I was there that day, I would have looked away, because I wouldn't have been able to stand the sight of what Jesus went through for us. Think about his body being broken, bruised and beaten, the incredible pain he went through for you and me. And then we think about his blood. If I can use the word weird, it's about the only word that comes to mind. It's the weirdest thing, but the most incredible weird. That blood in everyday life stains very easily. You get it in material and it just doesn't come out. But Jesus' blood washes away the deepest stain that is known to mankind, and that is sin. It's an incredible, incredible thought. I want to pray for a few minutes, and I'm going to serve this to my family. As soon as I pray, I'm going to start the song, and then at the end of the song, I'm going to have a closing prayer. So when the song starts playing, you can feel free to join in as well. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for the incredible sacrifice you made for us. It's beyond our understanding, our comprehension, but we're so grateful that you died for us, that you allowed your physical body to be brutalized and tortured to save us from our sins. You came as an unblemished lamb from heaven, and you died a battered, beaten, and bloody person. And it just is beyond my understanding, but thank you so much for doing so. Would you help each one of us here, everyone that's watching, to make this a very special worshipful time, realizing the incredible sacrifice that you made for us. In your name, amen. Just give me a few minutes to get the song started.
Because I know.
alive, folks. He lives today, and we can face tomorrow because he lives. Let's have a closing word of prayer this morning. Father God, thank you so much that you're alive. Thank you so much that you're with us. There are so many people hurting today, so many people afraid. May we as Christians show them that we serve a living Savior and we can face tomorrow because of you. Help us to be the light that we need to be to a hurting world right now. Would you come and bring healing to this land, to this country, to the world? Yes, we need healing from this physical virus, but we need healing in our souls. Help us to be that light, to show them how to receive the healing that you so wonderfully and beautifully gave us. Would you bless us this Easter Sunday? And would we bless you for what you've done for us? In your name, amen. Thank you for watching. I trust you have a beautiful Easter Sunday. I don't know what all you're going to be doing, and probably not anything traditional like we're used to. But I hope you have a beautiful day. God bless you all.